I'm trying to remember the sections, you know, trunk, branch, et cetera. And it happens to be right next to Peggy Sue Wells' essay. We are good friends that both live here in the Fort Wayne area, and our essays are back to back in the book. So I'm going to read for you right now, Bittersweet. I write the word bittersweet on a white napkin, pushing it across the table toward our exchange student. And his eyes absorb the word as he rolls it around on his tongue, his French accent punctuating it, his mind reaching to digest it. In French, they call it un moment du amer, a bittersweet moment. I relive the feelings with him as we talk over lunch, the high emotions he felt as he walked out of his U.S. high school for the last time, the friends and teachers he would miss, the way he fell in love with the school after all, even though it was bigger and crazier than his small French village, the reality that he will not see some of those friends again. Bittersweet, he says more firmly now, glad to name the feeling. It is a mother's job to help a child name things. With English fluency as the goal, I regularly named things for him. At the beginning of the student exchange year, I would point and say, this is my nose, these are my eyes, this is my mouth. And learning a new language and a foreign culture at the same time, this talkative yet reserved French teenager showed me the wonder of a three-year-old, the curiosity of a 12-year-old, and the drama of a 16-year-old, all wrapped up into one. The first week, Isaac routinely panicked unless he knew where I was, whether he was at Walmart, at the swimming pool, or even when waiting for us to come home. As he explored his new world, he needed me as a mother, a guide, and a friend. Isaac and I shared a right-brained, intuitive, creative view of the world, and there was now a human being within my home who noticed my new haircut, made dramatic statements about dreadfully ordinary occurrences, and plumbed the depths of human existence in daily conversations. I was smitten with mother love. Yet the story with our host son was born from amer douleur, or bitter sorrow. Our guest room, destined to be a nursery, lay empty. Not everyone who wants a child gets a child, I tried to explain to others who thought late marriage, infertility, and three failed adoptions just meant we needed to keep working at it to become parents. The baby was due on August 13th. Instead, 16-year-old Isaac arrived with jet lag and exhaustion on August 16th. This is like Wisteria Lane, he said as we drove into our neighborhood, and we laughed, rueful grins on our faces. I sit next to my husband on our navy blue love seat, a blank expression on my face. The birth mother sits across from us on a sweetheart red upholstered chair, and she is hardly able to get the words out of her mouth. My husband mutters some words like, well, thank you for telling us now. I recall it even now as the day hope died. 2 months earlier, she had sat at our dining room table over a piping hot bowl of homemade beef stew. She had told us she had chosen us to be her baby's parents. She had promised this adoption would not be like the others. And she had said, and I will never change my mind. She was an acquaintance with whom I had shared our desire to adopt, and she said she never wanted to parent at all, and she wanted to finish her college degree, to travel, to experience the world. She had placed a baby for adoption years ago. For 2 months, she insisted that she want her baby with us, and we relented. But the questions haunted us. Do we still want this? At ages 42 and 49, can this be trusted? Now our birth mother sits across from me, her whole body rigid as her mouth moves, But what about that first ultrasound and the pregnancy clothes we found for her, the meetings and the messages? And what about when she called us the day she fell down the stairs? Mercifully, she and the baby were not hurt. And what about the day she phoned to let me know the baby was a girl? And I screamed or I squealed, I can never remember which. I remember how we were partners, she and I in this unfolding drama, how she gave us her own childhood baby blanket for the baby, how natural it was to encourage her, how excited I was about her graduation that December, how I pictured us being there with baby in tow. She says unfolding family dynamics caused her to question her decision. She wants to become a parent after all. I had felt her uneasiness for the past week. I knew something was off. But my husband and I had promised up front we would never pressure her or coerce her. If this was to happen, it would happen on her initiative. I somehow managed to speak then, interrupting my thoughts. But you did all this. You pursued us. Yes. And I wish I hadn't.